Hi, this is Dave. So, what the strategic management account is going to do, very importantly, is to help the company's success. One of the ways they can do that is to predict what the company is going to go wrong. So from that perspective, after the strategic management accountant has predicted what the company would go wrong, of course, an appropriate series of measures will be put into place in order to prevent the company from going wrong. And from that perspective, one of the abilities that a strategic management accountant should have is to predict what the company will go wrong. So from that perspective, in this particular section is where we're going to have a look at the failure prediction. Okay, the company's failure prediction. So from that perspective, there are three particular aspects that we're going to look at. So firstly, are there any general factors that may imply the company will go into trouble? So of course the answer for that is yes. The idea behind it is that there would be business risks, right, associated with the company. As a result of that, the company would go wrong. So what do I mean by business risk? Is the risk that the business would go wrong due to these three factors. Firstly, operational factors. Secondly, financial factors. And thirdly, compliance factors. So compliance with the laws and regulation. So what are they then? So if we kindly turn back to your study notes, we can see those three factors here. So for example, operational issues within the company, what if the key staff within the high-tech industry company has left the company, and hence, you know, the research and development process has to be suspended. As a result of that, of course, that would be a big problem for the company, isn't it? Because if the company cannot come up with this particular intangible assets, for example, of course the company will not succeed, will not be successfully competing with other competitors. Also, if you've got a poor internal control system, so for example, the management within the company has breached the internal control systems very easily. For example, company has $1 million of cash. What if the CEO takes the cash from the company into his own pocket? As a result of that, by simply doing this kind of, you know, related party transactions, he can simply take the money from the company into his pocket without any disclosure because a poor internal system in place. As a result of that, of course, the company is lack of cash to do some further jobs. As a result of that, of course, the company will fail. Maybe the products are not innovative, they're out of date, the service is not in good quality. As a result of that, of course, the customer is not going to buy the products from you, but instead they're going to buy the products from your competitors, and hence, of course, the sales revenue falls, company will fail. Secondly, is due to the financial issues. So for example, your profitability is low, yes. Liquidity, such as the cash balances within your company, is low. Current ratio as well as the quick ratio is low, which means if the creditor, for example, calls in, of course you have to pay them the liability, you need to pay off the liability. As a result of that, because your liquidity position is poor, may suggest the fact that you may not have enough money to pay for them, yes, as the debt falls due. As a result of that, of course, maybe your company will be forced into liquidation, potentially. Gearing is too high. As a result of that, you have to pay for a higher amount of interest expenses. And also, one of the problems there is that it may be very, very difficult for you to renew your overdraft within the bank. As a result of that, given your liquidity position is low, status of the company is not very good, and also gearing is high, of course your company would go bankruptcy very, very easily. If you're not going to comply with the laws and regulations, for example, not only you're damaging your reputation, but also you are, you know, faced with a high amount of penalty potentially, and hence this will increase the cost, decrease the profit for your company, and hence these would be the general factors, general indicators that suggesting the company, you know, would go bankruptcy. So from that perspective then, you know, knowing those general factors are not enough, to be honest with you. Because as the professional strategic management accountant, what you need to do is to predict what's going on. So from that perspective, the second thing we're going to talk about is tools that we have in place in order to predict those failure that might happen. The first tool we're going to use is the quantitative approach. Where we're going to introduce the outcomes. Set score. And the other tool we're going to use is the qualitative approach. This is where we're going to introduce the agility A score. So, one is Z score, one is A score. That's it. Quantitative, which means we're going to calculate something. Qualitative, which means we are going to use some of the subjective assessments rather than the objective one, i.e. the numbers. So let's say, let's have a look at the first approach is the Altman's set score. Altman came up with a model called Z score. It's just a formula telling you if, after you've calculated, you know, all those variables using different figures from the SFP, from the income statement, and then you're going to plot them together, which will give you the Z. And said, if you end up being three, you know, more than three, the set value is more than three, of course the company is good, no problem whatsoever. If the set is lower than 1.81, they would go bankruptcy very easily. But here's the question. Has the Altman told us that when the company would go bankruptcy, if the set value is lower than 1.81? Well, the answer for that is no. So here's the problematic one. Although some of the companies will have, you know, the set value at, you know, maybe 1.5, it simply tells us the company may go into trouble very, very easily, but haven't told us yet about when. I guess that's the problematic one. And also, the problematic area number two is that if the set value falls within this period, which means falls within this range from 1.21 to 2.99, so for example 2.5, so from that perspective it simply means that the company needs to be further investigated what's going wrong. For example, if I were to give you the set value from 2011 up to the 2013, for example. 2011 is, 2.8, 2012, 2.7, 2013 is 2.6. So from that perspective, does it tell us anything? Well, the answer for that is yes, because, you know, the set value is falling and hence we need to further investigate what's going on. And the company's not doing a good job, yes. But it doesn't tell us that when the company will go bankruptcy, when the company's value, the set value, will fall below 1.81, given those figures in the, you know, from 2011 to 2013 are fall within this range. So as a result of that, of course, this would be the grey area. Okay, it's the grey area. So, you know, falls, you know, between this, you know, range, it doesn't mean that the company would go bankruptcy. So from that perspective, you know, we just need to further investigate what's going on. So that would be a great area. We, you know, maybe we can't do anything about it, but maybe we're going to come up with the new strategies, for example. So, you know, those are the areas that you can comment on. And it's highly unlikely for your examiner to ask you to calculate the Z value. So what the examiner's gonna do is to give you the Z value, give you all of the calculations, and all you need to do is to remember these three rules. Okay, more than three, good. Falls within this range, of course, grey area. Below this, goes bankruptcy very easily. So from that perspective then, given those figures we've noticed and remembered and we've calculated, of course, we need to take further action in relation to that. If the company, the set value falls below 1.81, for example, of course, we can take action. Or we can, ask the experts what would go wrong, and we're going to take some appropriate action against that. And maybe the management will accept there's a problem for that, yes, so the management is going to, you know, for example, is not going to do something about it. One of the examples I would like to give my students for this is that when the company's performance is not really, really good, but that particular company is the listed company. So from that perspective then, according to which, you know, depending upon which jurisdiction you're in, some of the stock exchange will put a special treatment of that particular company. So if the company is the listed company and its performance is really bad, as a result of that, it may be a target for many of these non-listed companies to acquire. For example, A company is the listed company already, but its performance is really bad. And B company wants to go listed, but B company does not want to go through a series of IPO process because it's time consuming, it's quite expensive. Alternative way the B's gonna do is to acquire this A company. And hence, this A company, although the Z score value is really low, management has said there's a problem for that, it's not going to do anything about it because the management A wants to sell this company to the management B. As a result of that, earn the premium out of it, that would be great for you. So it will depend upon which strategy that you're going to use. Okay, so not necessarily mean that the Z value will lower than this level, the company go bankruptcy, it's bad for the company, no. But it will depend upon actual situations. And, you know, for most of the companies, of course, if the Z value is lower than 1.81, of course, you're going to make some strategic changes. For example, maybe you're going to develop a new type of product. Maybe you're going to diversify your business because you think that the existing industry you're in is not profitable anymore. Particularly, there are lots of competition in there. As a result of that, you know, we can't share a very good market share in relation to that. As a result of that, I'm going to diversify my businesses as appropriate. Okay, you know, for most of the companies, of course, they would like to focus upon the government. So when the government has given some of the government policy in some of the areas, for example, if you are going to invest your money in this area, selling the high fashion clothes, for example, I'm going to give you a government grant. As a result of that, of course, you're going to do that because you can enjoy the benefit. So when, you know, trying to predict the failure, there are lots of things that you can use, okay? Also, you are going to improve your internal control systems as well. So what the internal control system actually do is to try to prevent the business risks or minimize the business risks that the company is facing. So for example, we are going to have a lot of procedures into place. For example, a separation of duties between the cashier and the accountant. So from that perspective, of course, we can prevent the situation where the cash will be stolen by the accountant very, very easily. So from that perspective, you know, that will be one of the measures that you can put into place. Okay, so that's the, you know, first approach that we can use. The second two we are going to use is called the Agendes A score. So We are talking about score here. From that perspective, so we are going to have a look at the marks, which means the score, by using these two models, yeah, trying to see whether the company is performing well or badly. So let's have a look at the agendas A score in the next page of your study note. Agendas A score simply means if you can find out some of the weaknesses within your company, this weakness will lead to the mistakes that is going to be made by the management. If the management has made those mistakes, of course, that will be the symptoms, you know, as a result of these mistakes that's been made by the management, and there will be the symptoms, you know, after that, suggesting the company will fail. So we're going to divide these three areas into lots of categories. So firstly, what are the common weaknesses, you know, within the company? There would be the management weakness, and there would be the accounting weakness. So the second one is that as a result of these weaknesses, the management would make the mistake, and hence that the company, you know, would easily go bankruptcy. And also, you know, some of the measures that would be put into place, so for example, creative accounting by the management, as a result of these of those mistakes has been made. And after we look at those, we can see on the right hand side there would be a score column here, you know, detailing different scores for each of these categories. And for these scores, of course, we're going to set a standard for that. On the next page of your notes, you can see that if the score for category A, which is the defects, is more than 10, of course, this is not acceptable. For B, more than 15, not acceptable. C, more than 0, is not acceptable. So a maximum score suggesting that your company is healthy is 25. Any score that is beyond 25 will not be healthy. Okay, so let's look at each of these categories in turn. Okay, so firstly, category number A is where we're going to look at the weakness, or we can call it as defects. So firstly, if the CEO is autocrat, if the CEO is autocrat, of course, he or she can decide what the company is going to do. And this will appear in the entrepreneurial style of the entrepreneurial company, especially for startup companies. That's no problem. But it suggests the fact that maybe the CEO can take the cash from the company very easily by committing some fraud, because he or she is so powerful. As a result of that, of course, he or she can tell the company what's going, you know, what to do. And also, he or she can, you know, breach the internal control systems quite easily, and that will be the first one. And if the CEO is autocrat, of course, the score for that is to 8, is to be 8. Okay, so you're going to put that 8 over there, that will be no problem. Secondly, if the CEO and the chairman would be the same person, but this is permitted under the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, but it's not permitted under the UK Corporate Governance Code, for example. So if this is the case, of course, if they are the same person, score would be 4. One of the disadvantages of those is that when the CEO is going to pass through a particular strategy, if the CEO and the chairman, which is the independent non-executive directors, if they are the same person, of course, you know, in passing a particular strategy, there would be 50% and more than 50% of yeses, yes, from the board resolution. But here, in this case, this is the board, and there'll be 5% and 5% over here. But now the CEO and the you know, chairman will be the same person, which may suggest the fact that maybe, you know, if five says yes, five says no, but if there's this chairman over here, it says no, that he can, you know, reject this strategy. But now the CEO and the chairman will be the same person, and hence it will easily pass through this particular strategy, for example. And hence, this is not very good. If there's a passive board of directors, which means the board of directors is not going to question about anything. It's not acting effectively, for example. It's not, you know, praise the individual directors within the board annually, and also it's not going to question about the validity and also the strategy of the strategy, and hence that would be the passive board of directors. And if this is the case, put the score of 2 next to that. If, for example, if the executive directors 5 person or non-executive directors 2 persons, there would be the unbalanced board of directors. As a result of that, put 2 next to that. Okay, so this is it. Also, if the finance director is quite weak, you know what I'm trying to talk about here is that the finance director is not qualified, not having enough experiences. Of course, 2 marks over there. If the management team is quite poor, which means it's not qualified, have not got any of these experiences, for example, of course, put 1 over there. So here's the problem you may come across, is that how can I define weak? Well, lots of definitions for that, but it really depends upon you know, which benchmark I'm going to use. Maybe you're going to compare the CEO from the, you know, top 500 companies with the CEO from the startup companies. Of course, they are not the same, right? So it's very, very subjective for you to define some of the, you know, items there. And hence, this will be the, you know, disadvantage when using this particular model. Okay, so defects relating to the accounting, for example, if there's no budget, that would be 3 marks for that. A common example I would give my student is that when you are going to build a website, if you are going to build a website, for example, you need to ensure appropriate budgets is allocated to them. It's simply because the web designers are, you know, working for you normally on a contract basis, or some of them work as the hourly basis. And they price quote it to you at the start before any of this design work is done. Of course, that would just to be based upon an estimate. So if you haven't allocated enough budgets into your company, into your plan for this particular project, and hence if there's any of these subsequent amendments to the website, of course the web designers will need to get the reimbursement from you. But if you haven't, you know, got any of these budgets relating to those unexpected reimbursements that may be in, that may be possible, of course that would be a problem for you. For example, you have to, you know, maybe the web designer would delay the project, so for example, if you haven't allocated appropriate budget, because you have to argue, you have to, you know, apply for those, you know, budgets for those reimbursements given to the web designers from the board of directors again, and this takes time. So from that perspective, if there's no budget, of course that would be the number 3. Also, one of the disadvantages if there's no budget is that, you know, instead of spending $10, maybe you're going to spend $20 because you haven't got any budget to them, haven't got any limits to them. As a result of that, of course, you know, your spends may not be quite normal, I should say, yes, because it's up to your discretion, isn't it, if there's no budget. If there's no forecast, especially for the cash flow forecast, of course, if there's no cash flow forecast, we cannot predict the return coming to the company, because every project we're going to invest our money into, we are going to compare the cost with the benefit. If there's no cash flow forecast detailing how much money we can make as a result of this project, firstly, we cannot persuade the board of directors or shareholders to approve this project quite easily. And secondly, we cannot compare the actual results with the projected one to see whether or not we have made a good job, we have done a good job. As a result of that, if there's no cash flow forecast, put 3 marks next to that. If there's no costing system, of course, that would be a disaster, especially for large companies. If you haven't got any of this costing system, you cannot determine the exact cost for each of the individual products, which means you cannot set up an appropriate selling price for each of the categories of the products very correctly. As a result of that, you know, this would be a disaster for your company. Put 3 marks next to that. If your product or service is out of date, your inventory is obsolete, cannot be sold back to the customer, and also your marketing method is, you know, very out of date. So for example, one of the common examples is that for most of businesses nowadays, they're going to use the e-commerce. E-commerce, which means we're going to trade with customers online. The customers can order your goods from your website and you're going to, you know, deliver the goods to them. That's it. You haven't got those websites, out of date marketing method, of course your company will not succeed quite easily. It's simply because in the market nowadays, if you're not going to lower down your costs, for example, for most of the companies, of course they're hard to survive in this particular market. So for example, if I'm going to use the e-commerce rather than, you know, employing a lot of salespersons to trade with customers and trade with the international customers, of course using the e-commerce will be cost effective, as you can see. Okay, because by using this e-commerce we can trade with customers internationally rather than appointing the salesperson to each of the countries in turn. As a result of that, this will save cost. If you haven't done that, if your product is out of date, etc., put 15 next to that. Yes, that's the category number A. Category number B is that because of the category number A weaknesses we identified, which means the defect, which means the management would make the mistakes very, very easily. For example, if you haven't got the cash flow forecasts, and then you're going to invest your money into different projects, where does the money come from? You have to borrow a lot of money from the bank, for example. But you actually cannot predict the exact amount of return that you're going to get at the end of a project live. So from this perspective, you're borrowing a lot of money from the bank, and hence you're going to pay for a high amount of interest expenses, for example. If there's a high gearing within your company, put 15 next to that. And because of those weaknesses, so for example, if you go turn back to those, I mean, the weaknesses over here, there would be a weak finance director, for example, which means if you're a weak finance director, if you haven't got any of this good relationship with the bank, with other, you know, finance provider, for example, of course, maybe you will lack the permanent fund. And maybe your company's policy is out of date, as we identified before. So as a result of that, well, maybe the bank is reluctant to lend the money to you because they cannot see the future for your company. And hence, you know, if you are, you know, trading your businesses quite a lot, for example, you're expanding your businesses quite a lot, but you haven't got enough fund in place to support those activities, that would be the overtrading. And then put 15 next to that. If you fail a particular big project, for example, if you're going to invest your money into India, for example, but if you fail that project, then you will lose a lot of things over there, so including your initial amount, you can't claim them back, and also you have to pay, for example, $5 million of the initial amount you borrowed from the bank. You need to pay back to the bank as a result of that, you know, failure to a project, and hence, you will, you know, accept a very, very, you know, series of consequences as a result. Of course, put 15 next to that. But here, you know, again, it would be quite subjective, as you can see. Yes, you can define whatever you want. And because of those mistakes that's been made by the management, it will lead to the category number C. For example, if you have a high gearing and, you know, overtrading, that kind of thing, maybe your set score would not be very good. Yes, because from the early calculation we identified different variables there, and if the financial position of the company is not very good, and hence the ZET score, you know, total value of the ZET will not be good as well. If the company fails the project, that the the policy is out of date, etc., and the intelligence systems is not very good because the management defects there, identifying the category number A, maybe there would be the creative accounting that is done by the management as well. In order to make the company look better, what I'm going to do is to overstate some of the profits. The simplest way we can do is to try to concentrate on the accounting estimate. For example, the level of warranty provision estimate, the allowance for doubtful debts. We're going to change the accounting policy from weighted average cost to the FIFO, etc. There are lots of ways that you can do. So, also, if the project fails and the product is not it's not attractive, it's not popular, it's just out of date. So of course, maybe the employees, the key employees, will leave the company. So those will be the non-financial indicators of the company. And if, for example, if there's a poor Z score, poor financial position, put 4 marks. Non-financial indicators is bad, put 4 marks, and creative accounting, put 4 marks over there. As a result of that, we can total up the marks that we can get from analysing this company. But as I said to you, that will be just subjective. You need to make sure, you need to know that which company you are comparing to, which industry you're in, so that you can define the exact amount for each of the category's components in turn. So, the total marks for all of them, of course I said to you, is 100, and if you score more than 25, of course it would suggest that your company is not doing really well, okay, here. So, that's all of the bits and pieces that you have to know. So, those are the two models. Finally, what I'm going to look at is that, are there any comments about the quantitative approach as well as the qualitative approach? Which approach are we going to use then? So, let's have a look at the advantages as well as the disadvantages in relation to each of these two models. So, right, let me just write it here as the comments bit. Firstly, we're looking at the ZET score, which is the quantitative approach. So, the advantage is that the information is available. The information is available, particularly for the statement of financial position, statement of profit and loss, statement of change in equity, statement of cash flow. They are all available, particularly for listed companies. You can download them easily from their website, and then use those information to calculate, just lock them into the formula. And the calculation is relatively simple, because that calculation is relatively simple. If you look back to the quantitative approach calculation, you can see that all you need to use is that it's working capital, retained earnings, reserve, PBIT, and then gearing for the X4, and then revenue. And then we also need the total assets, okay? Just divide by total asset for each of the categories. We can arrive at the X1 up to X5, okay? And then we're going to slot them into the formula, and then we can easily calculate the ZET compared to these three, decision rules. And it would be quite easy for you to do that. But the disadvantage of those is that there would be a grey area. The grey area from 1.81 to 2.99, you need to investigate what's going on. If it is falling, it doesn't mean that the company is really bad, because it hasn't, the figure is not below 1.8, as you can see, but it's just to be 1.81 to 2.99. As a result of that, those grey areas, how to deal with it. Secondly, any company's figure, the set figure is below 1.8, would not guarantee the company would go bankruptcy. Maybe the company is doing bad, yeah, in this year only. It does not mean that every company, any company, the set score is below 1.8, you would definitely go bankruptcy, no. But just to say that it is probable that a company will go bankruptcy. So this is the second disadvantage. Okay, and the third disadvantage is that the figures we just calculated are from the financial statements, and they are subject to manipulation. It is simply because, for example, for the statement of financial position, all of the figures there, lots of figures there, are based upon the accounting estimates as well as the accounting policy, and management can easily manipulate the figures by changing the accounting estimates or policies easily. So those are the advantages and disadvantages of the set score, which is the quantitative approach. When looking at the qualitative approach, firstly, advantage is that not only we consider the financial information because we're going to look at, for example, the symptoms, we're trying to look at the financial statement, financial information is calculated from the above, that's no problem. But here we are also including the non-financial information into the actual calculation. But the disadvantage is that it's quite subjective, isn't it? Because how to define weak, how to define poor, well, it really depends, yes? So from that perspective, those are the advantages and disadvantages of the quantitative as well as the qualitative approach. Okay, so we've finished off a section on how to predict the corporate failure.